Very good morning. This is the breakfast news on Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Ashwarya with you. All the biggest news stories from India and across the world coming up in the next 30 minutes. First up, the headlines. Karnataka governor sets deadline for trust vote, directs the Kumaraswamy government to prove majority by 1:30 p.m. today. Assembly adjourned amid din yesterday. BJP protests by spending night in Vidhan Sauda. Pakistan to grant consular access to Kulbhushan Jadhav after working out modalities. Islamabad will proceed as per law, says Imran Khan. In the Lok Sabha, Right to Information Amendment Bill 2019 and the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill 2019 likely to be introduced today. 162 members raised issues of public importance in Zero Hour on Thursday. Flood toll shoots up to 114 in Assam and Bihar. Over 1 crore people affected in both states. IMD issues red alert in 3 Kerala districts for heavy rains. And Rajya Sabha Television adds another feather to its cap, acquires 3 million subscribers on YouTube. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu congratulates RSTV management and employees on the achievement. The biggest story this morning in a dramatic twist to the ongoing political crisis in Karnataka, Governor Vajubhai Vala has written to the Chief Minister H.T. Kumaraswamy to prove the majority of his government on the floor of the House today on or before 1:30 p.m. today. Now, he has mentioned in the letter that 15 MLAs have handed over the resignation letter to him and 2 independents have also withdrawn support to the government. And with this, the governor said the government has been reduced to a minority. Now, this after the Karnataka Assembly was adjourned till today morning amid acrimony during the debate on the motion of confidence moved by Chief Minister H.T. Kumaraswamy to decide the fate of his 14-month-long government. The House was adjourned by Deputy Speaker Krishna Reddy as the Congress members persistently shouted slogans against the BJP. Meanwhile, MLAs led by B.S. Yedurappa resorted to overnight dharna in Vidhan Sauda, protesting against the adjournment of the assembly proceedings without taking up of the trust vote. 20 lawmakers did not turn up on Thursday, including 17 from the ruling coalition, 12 of whom are holed up in a hotel in Mumbai. Now, the government, which was formed with the support of 117 MLAs, has lost its strength by the resignation of 15 MLAs and the withdrawal of support from 2 independents. The Karnataka Assembly session will resume today at 11 a.m.
The governor has written a letter to the chief minister and the speaker. I don't know about the speaker. He has marked to the chief minister, letter chief minister, marked to the governor, speaker. He has said that on describing the every issues, 15 MLAs, Congress MLAs has withdrawn the support. Where is it? A governor certifying that he has withdrawn the support, himself prove that. It is a fit case for anti-defection law, 10 schedule. So when governors tell that they have withdrawn the support, nowhere the MLAs have said, except few of them, like Shankar and some of them have said that. But officially, governor communicating to the speaker and the chief minister, they have withdrawn the support, clearly shows that the anti-defection law can come into force. As per the 10th schedule, they are supposed to lose the membership and they can't become the members when they lose the membership.
Chief minister, though become minority government, he wants to continue his power. First priority is take the vote of confidence. By raising some point of order by Siddaramaiah, Krishna Bairegowda, everybody, they want to delay the vote of confidence. So there must be some time bond. There is a specific direction from the so many incidents. And even in the, if you see the last 20, 30 years, President in Karnataka, almost 7 times there was a vote of confidence. It is decided within one day.
And senior journalist Kestur Vasuki is joining us on the phone line from Bangalore. Very good morning, sir, and thank you so much for joining us here on Rajya Sabha TV. Sir, now the governor of the Karnataka has written to Chief Minister H.D. Kumaraswamy saying that prima facie you have lost majority and the ruling coalition will have to prove majority on the floor of the House by 1:30 p.m. today. What do you expect in the assembly today? Because, you know, a showdown is also expected between the governor and the Raj Bhavan. A matter is also likely to land in court. What do you, how do you look at the situation?
Aishwarya, it is very unprecedented as far as I'm concerned in the looking at the Karnataka Assembly. For the first time, governor has intervened in a particular day twice on the motion of trust vote. It's very unprecedented. But it is the, you know, the Congress and JDS, they are working out strategies to delay the trust motion on the trust vote. But I feel that, you know, when I spoke to some of the Congress leaders, they think that they are going to move the Supreme Court today and then find some remedy on the question of disqualification of the MLAs who are absent or MLAs, rebel MLAs. So these are the things happening. I don't know, but governor has very clearly told Kumaraswamy a letter addressed to him, and then he has also marked it to the speaker and said that he has to prove his majority on the floor of the House by 1:30 today. But, you know, what is going to happen? Will it lead to constitutional crisis? Hmm. It will be between a crisis between executive and the legislature. So I sincerely, you know, look at the entire drama. This government has become a minority government by all, you know, if you look at the number game. Hmm. One more MLA, meantime, he has escaped the Congress, you know, group and then went to Mumbai and got himself admitted to a hospital. So it has reduced to 99 and then, you know, it 105. So BJP has 107, 105 plus 2, 107. Yes. The majority is there. But what is the technicality? They are looking, you know, with the point of order and 10th schedule and all, Siddaramaiah and others, they are really dodging the debate. So they have forgotten the trust move yesterday, motion on the trust vote by the Chief Minister. They started discussing on the disqualification and other issues.
Yes.
They have also questioned the intervention of the Supreme Court. You know, the why Supreme Court should give that. Who, you know, Dinesh Gundura, the Congress working president, made it very clear. Why should they interfere in this? So this is, these are all the unprecedented things happened. But BJP, you know, they're very, very clear that it is only on the motion of the vote of the confidence where only one point agenda is that he has to prove his majority, and they're demanding the speaker, Ramesh Kumar, that he should only, debate should be on that, not any other point of order, which went to, you know, lot of acrimony, and then finally the deputy speaker Krishna Reddy had to adjourn the house. And then with looking at the entire drama, the thing is 10:30, 11, whatever is very crucial today. What is the game plan of JDS and Congress government? You know, if you if they miss, you know, they miss the bus, I mean, if they lose the government here,
yes,
it's very difficult for both Congress and JDS. Congress nowhere will be in the south. It is only Karnataka. Look
Absolutely.
At JDS. It's a regional party. And then if they lose the power, it is gone for them. Very few constituencies, they will have the their own MLAs. So with this, I sincerely feel it might lead to a kind of constitutional crisis where governor will take stringent measures like more keep the house under suspended animation if it moves. It may be a possibility. And also, you know, the Congress and JDS leaders, through the on the floor of the house, might you know, request the president to intervene. A lot of things are going to happen.
Absolutely.
And it is not that, it's not that easy. I don't see that, you know, Kumaraswamy will come and seek the trust motion. It is not that, and certainly it is going to create some kind of a constitutional constitutional crisis.
Indeed, Karnataka political crisis continues, but Karnataka governor has told the government in Karnataka very, very clearly, you have to prove majority by 1:30 p.m. We have to see what really happens in the state assembly today. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us and giving us the perspective on that big story. And on to some other news. Well, a day after the International Court of Justice at The Hague urged Pakistan to grant consular access to Indian national Kulbhushan Jadhav, Islamabad on Thursday said that Jadhav will be granted the right to get in touch with the diplomats and officials from India. In a statement, Pakistan Foreign Ministry said that modalities are being worked out to grant Jadhav consular access in accordance with the Vienna Convention. Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan also contended that his government shall proceed in the matter as per law. External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar on Thursday hailed the ICJ's verdict and termed it a vindication for India. And making a statement in both houses of parliament, Jaishankar urged Islamabad to release and repatriate him immediately. The MEA has also asked Islamabad to immediately grant consular access to Jadhav, saying that the ICJ clearly mentioned that the judgment is final, binding and without appeal.
Frankly, it seems to me that they are reading from a completely different verdict. The main verdict is in 42 pages. If there is no patience to go through the 42 pages, I think they should go through the 7-page press release, where each and every point has been ruled in favor of India. I don't think there is any confusion on that account. I think they have their own compulsions as to why they have to lie to their own people.
Shri Kulbhushan Jadhav is innocent of the charges leveled against him. No forced confession, that too without legal representation and due process, will change this fact. We once again call upon Pakistan to release and repatriate him forthwith. I am confident that the House will join me in expressing its strongest solidarity with Sri Jadhav's family. They have shown exemplary courage in difficult circumstances. I can assure that the government will vigorously continue its efforts to ensure Sri Jadhav's safety and well-being, as well as his early return to.
Our colleague Akhilesh Suman is now joining us live for more on that story. Akhilesh, now Pakistan says that consular access to Kulbhushan Jadhav will be given according to our laws. And Pakistan also says that modalities are being worked out for the same. What more can you tell us? What is happening?
You know, so writings are on the wall. What is the writing? Writing has come after the ICJ verdict. And ICJ verdict tells them to do two basic things before they reconsider and review the whole case. The two basic things are, tell Mr. Kulbhushan Jadhav that what are his rights and how he can defend about it. The second thing, since he's an Indian citizen, India has to be given access to Mr. Jadhav. That means Mr. Jadhav will be given consular access. These are the two things that ICJ had told. And we were keeping the fingers crossed yesterday that whether when it comes. And it came a bit late in the night, but it came in the way that Pakistan Foreign Ministry said that we have told, means Pakistan Foreign Ministry have told Mr. Jadhav that what are his rights to defend himself. And other thing, that consular access will be granted to India according to their own law. Naturally, it is his country, so they will do according to their own law, and modalities are being worked out. So these are the two things. One can say that yes, Pakistan till now is following the verdict of ICJ, because ICJ has told to do act upon the decision immediately. And yesterday, when External Affairs Minister was speaking in Parliament, and then External Affairs Ministry spokesperson was talking to us, the things were very clear that we are telling Pakistan to do it really immediately and follow the processes as per ICJ verdict, and then return Mr. Jadhav as soon as possible to all India. Right. So I think these are the things that ICJ has told Pakistan, and Pakistan is also under tremendous pressure now. The world situation is not like 20 years earlier when Pakistan could bargain with lobbying with different parties. Now world is in a different mode, and Pakistan, I think, will have to obey what is the ICJ telling, and I think that is the result. And in a day or two, we may see that they are making some court to hear the case, you know.
All right. Stay with us, Akhilesh. We'll just come back to you. And India has termed Pakistan's arrest of Mumbai terror attacks mastermind Hafiz Saeed a drama. MEA spokesperson Ravish Kumar said that Pakistan's drama of arresting the Jamaat-ud-Dawah chief has been on since 2001. He said that Pakistan has arrested Hafiz Saeed over 8 times but released him on some ground or the other. The MEA also asked if Hafiz Saeed's arrest on Wednesday would be more than a cosmetic exercise this time. Ravish Kumar expressed hope that Hafiz Saeed will be brought to justice this time.
This drama, I to my count, I think it has been more than 8 times since 2001. We have seen this drill. The question is whether this time this will be more than a cosmetic exercise, whether Hafiz Saeed will be tried and sentenced for his terrorist activity.
And on to news on budget session of Parliament. Well, 4 bills are listed in today's agenda in the Lok Sabha. 3 bills listed for introduction include the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill 2019 to provide for the protection of rights of transgender persons and their welfare, and the Banning of Unregulated Deposit Schemes Bill 2019 to provide for comprehensive mechanism to ban unregulated deposit schemes to protect the interests of depositors. And the Right to Information Amendment Bill 2019 to amend the Right to Information Act 2005. And the Protection of Human Rights Amendment Bill 2019 to amend the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993 is also listed for consideration and passing. And House will also take up Private Members' Bill, including a bill on measures for utilization of water resources by BJP MP Annapurna Devi. Well, the ongoing session of the 17th Lok Sabha has been the most productive in the last 20 years, with the lower house registering 128% productivity till Tuesday. Lok Sabha members discussed the general budget for 17 hours, demands for grants for the Ministry of Railways for 13 hours, and for the Ministry of Road and Transport for more than 7 hours. And according to Speaker Om Birla, members discussed demands for grants for Rural Development and Agriculture Ministry for 10.36 hours, and issues related to Sports and Youth Affairs Ministry for 4.14 hours. And a total of 162 members raised issues during the extended 0 hour on Thursday, which went on for 4 hours and 50 minutes before the House was adjourned at 10:50 p.m.
162 मान्य सदस्यों ने जीरो ओवर में 4 घंटे और 50 मिनट में अपनी बात रही. इसके लिए मैं सभी मान्य सदस्य जो अंतिम समय तो उनको
आपका विशेष धन्यवाद.
मान्य पार्लियामेंट अफेयर्स मिनिस्टर,
हम सरकार की तरफ से माननीय स्पीकर साहब को भी और सभी स्टाफ को भी मैं धन्यवाद समर्पित करता हूं.
सभा की कार्रवाई कल दिनांक 19 जुलाई 2019 को सुबह 11 बजे तक के लिए स्थगित की जाती है.
Let's go back to Akhilesh Suman, who's joining us from Parliament. Akhilesh, we've been discussing how the ongoing session of the 17th Lok Sabha has been one of the most productive sessions in the last 20 years. And as far as today is concerned, there are 4 bills that are listed in the Lok Sabha. And of course, it is a Friday, so day for private members' bills as well. What can we expect in the Lok Sabha today?
You know, Aishwarya, when the House runs, it is really a testing time for everyone. And when the House runs for 0 hour, 0 hour is also a very difficult time as far as the government is concerned, because people, members from different parties, including the treasury benches, they raise the question that government has to act upon. And that is why 0 hour is given, that these are the issues that has to be raised on the floor of the House, that has immediate issue that will be, you know, related to the life of people in different parts of the country. So given the fact that 162 members raised the questions in 0 hour was really a nice thing to watch. for journalists also, because journalists also have to sit for longer hours to cover the proceedings. So I think the type of discussion that is taking place in both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, I feel that if you see Lok Sabha, there are bills though for introduction, and in Rajya Sabha there are private members bill, and all the five private members bill are very interesting, because private members bill give the opportunity to the parliamentarians to think about legislation, to think about the issues.
Yes.
And these are the private members' legislation the government may pick up to take its own legislation, because generally it is understood that once private member legislation comes, members from different political parties speak on that, and then government requests them to withdraw it, and then government assures them that we will come with another bill if it is required. So these are the processes. So this is very interesting process of parliamentary practice. And
indeed,
today
and in the Rajya Sabha also, it is the day for the private members' business today. Stay with us, Akhilesh, because we also need to discuss about Rajya Sabha. Well, members Vijaypal Singh Tomar and Ripun Bora, as well as Hanumantha Amar Shankar Sable and Harnath Singh Yadav, will move bills on issues including farmers' welfare, racial discrimination against people from the northeastern states, primary education, formulation of child safety norms for urban areas, and the formulation of a stringent population control policy. And Rajya Sabha yesterday passed two bills that provide for changes in the arbitration laws. Both New Delhi International Arbitration Centre Bill and Arbitration and Conciliation Amendment Bill were passed by the Upper House on Thursday. The bill seeks to improve institutional arbitration by providing for settlement of commercial disputes within 6 months. It aims to make India a hub of domestic and global arbitration for settling commercial disputes. The New Delhi International Arbitration Centre Bill has already been passed by the Lok Sabha. And the Arbitration and Conciliation Amendment Bill 2019 that seeks to make changes in the existing law of 1996 will now go to Lok Sabha.
This whole arbitration ecosystem, as I said, is being sought to be built in the context of a larger narrative to make India a good place for doing business, for investment, and also for dispute resolution.
And the government also introduced the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Amendment Bill 2019 in Rajya Sabha on Thursday. Now, this bill seeks to amend the existing POCSO law of 2012. It also provides for the enhanced punishment of sexual crimes committed against children. And according to the bill, those committing penetrative sexual assaults on a child below 16 years of age would be punished with imprisonment up to 20 years. The punishment may extend to life imprisonment as well, fine. And to curb child pornography, the bill provides that those who use a child for pornographic purposes would be punished with imprisonment for up to 5 years and a fine. However, in the event of a second or a subsequent conviction, the punishment would be 7 years and a fine. The bill also empowers the centre to make rules for the manner of deleting or destroying or reporting about pornographic material in any form involving a child to the designated authority.
Srimati Smriti Jubin Irani to move for leave to introduce the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Amendment Bill 2019.
Sir, I rise to move for leave to introduce the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Amendment Bill 2019.
The question is that leave be granted to introduce the bill. Those in favour will please say aye.
Aye.
Those against will please say no. I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it.
I introduce the bill.
Let's go back to Akhilesh Suman, who is joining us from Parliament. Akhilesh, as well as Rajya Sabha is concerned, it passed two bills that provide for changes in arbitration law. Also introduced the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Amendment Bill in Rajya Sabha yesterday. How does the day look like in Rajya Sabha today?
Yeah, in Rajya Sabha today, I think I was telling that, you know, there will be private members' resolution, and there are five private members' resolution, and these private members' resolution are considered to be very important. And generally, the concerned members who come with their own private member schedules, and they also motivate other members to join hands with him and to take part in the discussion, because it's a private member's resolution. Government doesn't have any control over it. So sometimes you'll see the members persuading others members to come sit and then take part in deliberation. And it happens many a times that government also comes under pressure. This is a very interesting time for parliamentarians who understands the legislative process and who also puts pressure on the government to take understand one issue that is very important, to press upon one issue. And like private member resolution is coming about Kisan Ayog, establishment of Kisan Ayog. This demand has been there in the country for many years, and once it is coming as private members resolution, I think the government will have to reply. If it is not finishing today, government will reply in later times, but government later has to reply that what government intends to do, otherwise it will go for voting. There are other private members resolution like nationalization of primary education. This is also very interesting because the country
legislations that are scheduled for the day. Thank you so much, Akhilesh, for all those updates. We're just running out of time, but thank you so much for all those updates. And on to some other news now. The flood fury in Bihar and Assam has left over 1 crore people in the throes of despair, even as the death toll climbed to 114. The swollen rivers in the two states have washed down villages, towns and livelihoods in the two states. In Bihar, the death toll from floods shot up to 78, with 11 more casualties reported during the last 24 hours. Altogether, 18 people have died in Sitamarhi district alone on the Indo-Nepal border. Over the last few days, the state is grappling with flash floods caused by torrential rains in Nepal. Meanwhile, in Assam, over 54 lakh people were affected as the floods claimed 9 more lives in the state, taking the total number of those dead during the current spell of monsoon rage to 36. More than 2.26 lakh people have been displaced and they are taking shelter in more than 1,000 relief camps, with the large areas of 28 of the state's 33 districts affected. And with the 2 more deaths in Meghalaya, the toll in floods in the state rose to 8, while over 1.55 lakh people were affected by the deluge. Meanwhile, in Kerala, the Indian Met Department has sounded a red alert in 3 districts of the state that are likely to receive extremely heavy rainfall in the next 2 to 3 days. And Rajya Sabha television has achieved yet another milestone. 3 million people have given thumbs up to Rajya Sabha television, with 1 million subscribers added in the past 5.5 months. Over 6,000 viewers are subscribing to the channel every day. And Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has congratulated Rajya Sabha TV in a Twitter message. He complimented the management, editorial and the technical teams of RSTV for the achievement. On that happy note, we wrap up this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching. Have a great day ahead.